I think this is the strongest medium ever created in the history of the human species, bar none. I think it attacks the subconscious mind in a way that we have no idea of what the impact is.
Movies change you, you know, when you're watching them. It's like you go into a dreamlike state. You suspend your disbelief and you enter this magical world.
Hollywood is very influential in placing in the minds of people images of what we Latinos are.
Smoke on your pipe and good luck.
So movies all of a sudden become what you're represented as.
They become the subconscious images that the rest of the world will have.
In order to understand Hollywood's portrayal of Latinos, you have to understand the evolution of the industry itself.
Movie making was a wondrous new medium born with the new century. Its inventors were East Coast immigrants who came to Los Angeles for the good locations and the year-round sun. They came to a city that not only had a Spanish name, but had been part of Mexico only 60 years earlier.
I think over the long throw of the 100 years of Hollywood cinema, you've seen the Latino come and go. Mexicans showed up in movies from the very beginning. They were playing Indians and they were playing pirates, perhaps, and in many instances playing Mexicans. They were always around.
In the early 1900s, motion pictures told simple stories of good guys and bad guys. Some of the movie's first bad guys were called greasers, a dangerous people prone to violence and mayhem.
The term initially comes from the fact that Mexicans, by and large, worked on the shipyards in California loading hides onto boats, get the tallow all over themselves and become greasy.
The figure of the greaser, the amoral lowlife, kidnap white women and kill the bandolero, the bandit, the greaser. It was such a horrible depiction of Mexican nationals, but by depicting the Mexican national like that, they were really depicting every Latino.
Hollywood discovered a moneymaker. What more do you need? He's got a bad guy, he's dark, he's dumb for the most part, he's violent, a rapist, you know, can't speak the language. All of that really works well with the needs of a compact screenplay.
And the bad girls in these early films were oftentimes Mexican women, portrayed with a violent nature and loose morals.
And there was terrible propaganda. And anything associated with Mexico was viewed to be as treacherous and evil, bloodthirsty.
We get a sense that obviously these were popular films. We also see that in the Spanish language newspapers in the Mexican-American community that these films upset people, and there's a number of instances of people walking out of the theaters, editorialists getting boycotts started, of theater owners deciding not to show the films.
There was such a terrible stereotype that Latin American countries got together and said, we're gonna boycott every single U.S. film that comes to our countries if you don't change this. And in fact, they did.
In 1922, the Mexican government announced a ban of any movie by any company who made an offending film. President Wilson himself felt it necessary to intervene by asking the Hollywood movie people to, quote, please be a little kinder to the Mexicans.
The other thing that happened at the beginning of the 20s was the rise of the Latin lover because of Rudolph Valentino.
The first Latin lover was not Valentino, who was Italian. It was Antonio Moreno, who was from Spain.
Antonio Moreno once told an interviewer, quote, I was promoted as to what you now call a sex symbol, though I did nothing to encourage this perception. But Americans wanted to believe that the people of Latin origins are more naturally spicy.
This craze was so popular and so powerful that in the wake of Valentino, you have Gilbert Roland, you have Ramon Navarro, you have Lupe Velez, you have Dolores Del Rio. And all these are stars that are taking advantage of this kind of trend in Hollywood. Let's find the Latin type.
Latinos were an image of romanticism, the Latin lover, the beautiful women like Lupe Velez.
And she begins in the 20s in silent films, and she does a film called The Gaucho with Douglas Fairbanks Sr. in 1928. Much holds her own with this hero of Hollywood.
If you were Ramon Navarro or Dolores Del Rio, you were not playing the greaser or the dim-witted senorita. You were the star of the show. You were playing somebody who was noble, usually aristocratic, and you might be playing anything from French to Polynesian, American, Eskimo, British, because, of course, in silent movies, there were no accents. Dolores Del Rio was from Mexico and proud of it. She came from a semi-aristocratic family, but what Hollywood did was Europeanize her. She resented this, but the only background that was esteemed in Hollywood at that time, and for a long time after, was the European background. The Latin lover was a very profitable figure, to the extent that you had somebody like Jacob Krantz, who was of Austrian Jewish background. His name was changed to Ricardo Cortez so that he would make more money for his studio. Now, somebody non-Latin taking on a Spanish name is unthinkable today, but in the silent era, it made total sense. Ramon Navarro was the first Latin American star. He was from Mexico. He was a cousin to Dolores Del Rio. He had the great good fortune to be cast in Ben-Hur, the most expensive silent movie ever made, and a huge success.
I saw Ben-Hur in Mexico. That chariot race was very, very exciting. This was long before I ever dreamed that I would come to Hollywood. But that was terrific. So you can imagine when I came here and was meeting Ramon Navarro. He was so handsome. Oh, fantastic. You know, it was our idol.
The introduction of sound to films presented problems for many actors.
Well, when talkies came in, it was a disaster for anyone who had a foreign accent, unless perhaps you were British. There were many people whose careers were ruined, Hungarians as well as Mexicans.
What's the idea of giving a party and not inviting me, huh?
Interestingly, there was a double standard that benefited women.
¿Qué espera usted eso, eh? Esto. Así nada más eso espera. Son desgraciados narices de perico.
Don't speak.
Men with accents like Gilbert Roland and Antonio Moreno became supporting actors almost overnight.
Come up again, anytime.
I shall. Then I hope you will be alone.
So do I.
Because the American male establishment was threatened by the foreign men.
Warm, dark, and handsome.
Lupe Velez, Dolores Del Rio continued right on with their careers as though nothing had happened.
Well, you know what I think of you? Cara de perra animal, eh? Andy, chocante, vieja. Paren las narices de palo que tiene. Answer me. Hello. Hello.
She hung me up.
Lupe Velez was best remembered as the Mexican Spitfire and therefore a comedian.
Lupe Velez has been a very underrated actress, but she was a remarkable comedian. I mean, she was basically a predecessor to Lucille Ball. She was extremely popular with Latino audiences. She was extremely popular in Latin America.
No, I fix. Tell the old sourpuss not to come up.
She was called a hot-blooded Mexican, a hot tamale. But there was a lot of, we have a lot of indication that Lupe Velez herself was very much in charge of manufacturing that image as well, because she, in a lot of ways, knew that that was the only way that she could get a job in Hollywood.
Silent films were easily exported, but talkies changed all that. To keep the highly profitable international film market, Hollywood shot films in English during the daytime hours and Spanish language versions during the graveyard shift. Lupita Tovar starred in the Spanish language Dracula.
It was very difficult. We reported to makeup at 6 o'clock and we started shooting at 8. See, the English cast had gone out and then we go in. In the meanwhile, they change the lighting, they change the nose, some things. Then we work all night. Dracula was finished before the English version. We were one take, you know, we were very, very good. We were then competing with the English because we wanted to prove that we were better, if not the same better, than the American actors. We knew that we were paid less. I didn't care because it was enough for me and happy to have a job. So when our picture was finished, there was a lot of talk around the studio that the Dracula in Spanish was better then. So we were very proud.
During the Great Depression, there was an incredible concern about Mexicans taking U.S. jobs. So after the stock market crash, you had this massive deportation of Mexicans, many of them U.S. citizens. So here you have their presence in politics, their presence in newspapers, and their absolute absence on the silver screen.
When Latins were portrayed during the Great Depression, they were usually aristocratic South Americans in escapist fantasies.
Whenever a Brazilian girl starts something, she must finish it.
South Americans got below the equator that we haven't.
Loris Del Rio, who played a Brazilian, not a Mexican, wore a two-piece swimsuit, which was revolutionary at the time. This was one of the things that helped lead towards the very right-wing censorship code that came in July of 1934, the Hays Code.
Dina, your robe.
So Dolores Del Rio had her share in bringing on censorship.
The flip side of the Latin image as an aristocrat was the dim-witted clown. Some talented actors made the best of this caricature. Crispin Martin provided comic relief in a number of Hollywood productions, often playing the cowpoke without a clue.
You come along, or else.
Or else what?
Just or else! Say, Manuel, what does mean this or else, anyhow?
Huh? Oh, you make no difference what it means. You come with us, or we put the spots on you.
Leo Carrillo, who was Mexican-American, was a very successful, very prolific character actor.
Who was he telling me to shut up?
He didn't say it, senor.
Well, somebody say it. I say it, and I say it again, Pelado.
So what?
So this!
Hey, Pancho, if we're going to kill those fellas in Telica, we better go pretty quick.
He played in dozens and dozens of movies. He came from a very aristocratic Spanish-Mexican family that had owned a big chunk of Los Angeles.
Hollywood's attraction to the Mexican bandido began during the Mexican Revolution of 1910. The Mutual Film Corporation approached Mexican revolutionary Pancho Villa with an offer of $25,000 to film his exploits. In need of money for his troops, Villa agreed to fight during the daylight hours and delay his attacks until the cameras were ready to roll. The film was called Barbarous Mexico and portrayed Villa's popular revolt against the tyrannical government as violent and uncivilized. A quarter of a century later, Pancho Villa made his return to Hollywood, this time in a fictionalized version starring Wallace Beery, portrayed not only as a killer, but also as a clown.
Viva Villa has a character in Pancho Villa who is very childlike, who cannot think for himself.
Don't understand what's wrong with the
pigeons! Pigeons! Well, you're crazy, that's all. Didn't I tell you not to draw pigeons on the money? Why didn't you draw a bull?
He's very childish and animalistic and savage.
You.
Oh, now listen, I only know how to make love one way. If I see an angel, I got to make love. That way, I've got to grab.
If you know anything about Mexican history, you realize that the soldiers, the rebels that were fighting with Zapata and Villa, were actually heroic. I mean, what they were up to was defeating tyranny.
During this time, Latinos began to break into the filmmaking industry behind the camera. Mexican-born brothers Marcel and Victor Delgado were the men behind the ape in King Kong, constructing the giant's piercing eyes, its roaring mouth, and the huge hand that held the beautiful Fay Wray. Chico Day broke through as a first assistant director working on Cecil B. DeMille's epic films, The Ten Commandments, in Samson and Delilah. For the next five decades, Chico Day would work on some of the biggest films in Hollywood history.
I was the first Latin to open the gate for the Latins in our business at Paramount. So that naturally gives me a great feeling of pride in having been instrumental in opening this horrible barrier that they had at that time for Latins.
Señor Gonzalo Sebastián Rodrigo Don Juan Chicuelo.
Don Juan? The great lover, huh?
Si, señorita. I was named for him.
The Cisco kid, he was a good guy. And just the fact that you had a Latino good guy was rather revolutionary.
Zorro, the fictional hero of old Spanish California, began his career in the silent days. The Cisco kid became a major popular icon in over 20 films, a Robin Hood-like hero who rode the West righting injustices. The role was played by many, including Warner Baxter, Gilbert Roland, Duncan Reynaldo, and Cesar Romero, who added his own debonair style.
Señorita, it's an honor.
The Cisco Kid has proven timeless. The latest incarnation of this fictional Latin hero was Jimmy Smits.
Let's ride!
Hollywood's first film about a contemporary fictional Mexican-American hero was Border Town. The lead role was played by Paul Muni, a versatile non-Latino actor.
That young man, ladies and gentlemen, sits there, Johnny Ramirez.
You've got this character who goes to a law school, not a very good law school in East LA, and in his very first trial, loses the case, gets into a fight with the opposing attorney.
It's because you don't want a guy like me who comes from where I do to get a break.
It isn't a question of nationality or creed. It's you. You're a ruffian at heart. Brutal, cheap, bad-tempered.
He is disbarred, so he retreats to a border town in Mexico and runs a casino.
I'm asking you to marry me.
Oh, but that's out of the question. You must understand that, Johnny.
No, I don't understand. Why?
Because you belong to a different tribe, Savage.
He fails at everything he tries to do, so he retreats back to the barrio, back to East L.A.
Well, Juanito, where to now? Back where I belong, Padre, with my own people.
So it ends up being a cautionary tale to Mexican-Americans. Don't try to go outside the barrio. Don't try for mainstream success. Stay where you are. That's where you belong.
Hollywood's first portrayal of a real-life Latin American hero was Mexico's beloved president, Benito Juarez, again played by Paul Muni.
Only a word. Democracy may stand between Maximiliano von Habsburg and myself, but it is an unbridgeable gulf.
And if you take yourself back to 1939, you realize there just weren't very many positive portrayals, and there weren't, there weren't many pictures that the whole picture was set in Mexico or Latin America, that it was trying to be a positive portrayal, that it was trying to do justice to Mexican history.
Camilo, picture. The gringo? Yes, Camilo. The gringo.
Paradoxically, the biggest boost to the Latin image in Hollywood films resulted from world events an ocean away.
Between 1935, the ascension of Hitler, and all of these events taking place, setting up the scenario for the Second World War, the U.S. then all of a sudden felt that it had to do something to secure its shores. And one way to secure the shores was to create a better relationship with countries south of the border so that they would not become the basis for German submarines or Japanese submarines or whatever. So the whole policy, good neighbor policy, began.
The European movie market was closed because it was at war with itself. And so Hollywood had to then skew all of its product toward new markets, so they skewed it toward South America, Central America, and Mexico. And they made a lot more films that were attractive to that market.
We're three happy chappies with snappy serapis. You'll find us beneath our sombreros. We're brave and we'll stay so. We're bright as a peso. We say so, the three caballeros.
There was a need to create a paradise, a distraction. So Latin America became this fabulous playground with music and ruffles and exotic ladies who danced with a rose in their teeth and men who walked around with long sideburns and tall boots and drinking mate and dancing tango and whatever.
Hollywood courted Latin America with romantic musical comedies, and new actors were literally brought in off the boat.
I was a child when I saw Carmen Miranda in those first color movies, musicals, and she was always... What attracted me was how could she hold so many bananas on her head?
Well, she was criticized in Brazil because they thought that she was sort of making a caricature of Brazil, but that's not the point. The point is, I mean, we can't lose totally our sense of humor. We've got to evaluate things for what they are. A musical comedy is far from being an interpretation of the Declaration of Independence. I mean, a musical comedy was to entertain.
I will do my best to make Senorita Spencer ecstatic.
That ought to be good enough. You Cubans are supposed to be experts at romance.
Oh, I am not a Cuban, senor. I was born in Brooklyn as a child.
By the early 40s, many Latino actors were enjoying both the work and the play as members of Hollywood's social elite.
At the Beverly Hills Tropics, patrons who've always longed to get away from it all on some South Sea island can capture the illusion and still be just around the corner from home. Then in strolls Cesar Romero, enjoying a day of leisure between pictures. Gee, maybe this is one of those wild Hollywood parties they talk about. Aha, new recruit, Rita Hayworth. And nice, too. Apparently, Caesar agrees with us. He almost breaks a leg getting over to sit next to Rita. You're going to hear a lot more about this Hayworth gal.
There was great activity in this town all the time, and socially it was wonderful.
The swanky West Side Tennis Club, where tournaments bring out a gallery that looks like an all-star cast.
All your friends were members there. We go there, we played tennis, we played backgammon, we played gin.
That's Gilbert Rowland, who swings a mean racket. He sees a fast one coming. He dashes to the net. He jumps over. Oh, wrong again. He was just going up for a high one.
It was a great social place.
If horse racing is your weakness, you'll want to see Santa Anita, Hollywood's pet playground.
That's Lupe Velez taking her glasses off. And that's Antonio Marino keeping his on.
Then the war came along, of course, and that changed everything.
By the time we're into World War II, which is early 40s, you need to show the country united against the common foe. So what you do is, in the foxhole, you put everybody. It's a cross-section of America.
Cuban newcomer Desi Arnaz was featured as a heroic soldier fighting in the Philippines.
Hey, what's the matter with you?
Just tired, long night we put in.
No, sir. I'm no doctor, but I worked in a drugstore once. You're sick.
Don't you go saying that. Don't you say that to anybody. I mean it.
Arnaz, the pronunciation he preferred, created I Love Lucy, one of the most successful television series ever, which established him as a leading Hollywood TV producer. And in the popular World War II epic Guadalcanal Diary, Anthony Quinn played a key role as a Mexican-American Marine private.
If I was back in Laredo, I'd go and see my Conchita. Maybe Lolita.
Well, make up your mind.
All right, Conchita and Lolita.
Latinos were among the most highly decorated servicemen in World War II, with many awarded the Congressional Medal of Honor. Hollywood paid homage to the Latino servicemen in a modest film called A Medal for Benny.
Mr. Martin, your son's a hero.
I'll say he is. Killed more than 100 Japs all by himself.
Benny? A soldier?
He sure wasn't picking spinach.
For soldiers fighting overseas, Rita Hayworth was a favorite pinup. What they didn't know was that this Hollywood beauty queen began her career as Margarita Cancino, performing with her family, the Dancing Cancinos, in U.S. and Mexican nightclubs. Arriving in Hollywood, this young actress of Spanish descent portrayed dark-eyed, dark-haired, exotic beauties that range from Egyptian to Mexican. 10 films later, Hollywood set out to de-Latinize Margarita Cancino. Her dark hair was dyed blonde and then tinged red.
People used to say, oh, you know, Rita wasn't that good looking until they changed her hair. And then I went into the books and I would look and see Rita when she was really super young, just a teenager with a dark, dark hair, and she was gorgeous.
Hilda, are you decent?
Me?
Finally, her name was changed and Margarita Cancino emerged as Rita Hayworth, the all-American dream girl.
Sure, I'm decent.
Hayworth epitomized classic 1940s glamour with intelligence and humor.
His name is Johnny, Gilda.
Oh, I'm sorry. Johnny is such a hard name to remember and so easy to forget.
You know, with a change in the tint of the hair, they may have blue eyes, they may have green eyes, they're very light-skinned, and so the world looks at them, the world doesn't realize that these people are Latinos.
That's the story that went around, but he's the real lowdown. Put the blame on me, boy. Put the blame on me.
Rita Cancino. I don't know, Rita Cancino would have gone as far as Rita Hayworth did.
When I was first starting the business, they always told me to change my name because Leguizamo nobody could pronounce and it was too Latin.
They wanted to misspell my first name, C-A-E-S-A-R, instead of Cesar, to make it the English Caesar. But I said, no. I said, my name is Cesar Romero and that's the way it's going to stay.
She really very, very seriously told me that I should really, if I wanted to work, change my name to Elizabeth Sterling. And I said, I should talk like this for the rest of my life. Elizabeth Sterling. I don't know if I could pull that off. I have a banana stain all over my body.
They were going to call me Ricky Martin. And I said, Ricky Martin. Well, I said, no, my name is Montalban.
Maybe we could get you more work if you changed your name. Because your name is too ethnic. And I said, excuse me, have you looked at me? I am ethnic.
People could never pronounce my name, Le Cubano, Legs in Ammo, Legs in Gumbo, whatever it was, you know, nobody could ever say it. So I was like so used to my name being a pain that I said, I'm sticking with it, it's made me who I am.
In the classic Western era, complex Latino characters emerged, along with the timeless bandido.
I Don't Have to Show You No Stinking Badges is the name of a play that I wrote a few years ago about Hollywood and Latino Hollywood. And really, what it refers back to is the treasure of Sierra Madre and Alfonso Bedoya, who was an outstanding image. Negative, unfortunately, but an outstanding image of the Mexican.
Alfonso Bedoya comes on as the outlaw Mexican. And he's sweaty and he's dirty. And he says, I ain't badges.
We don't need to show you no stinking badges.
Don't have to show you no stinking badges, you know. Bedoya, it's a friend of mine, very funny, very good.
Alfonso Bedoya continued to play comical, but menacing Mexicans in the movies.
Makes his own fire.
In the Oxbow incident, a Mexican vaquero is wrongfully accused of murder. About to be lynched by a posse, he faces death with dignity and honor.
Now put up your hands.
No sabe.
It's all right, brother, you will.
the Anthony Quinn character, who looks like just another Mexicano, another bandido in a Western. But he's hiding behind the stereotype to try and figure out what's going on here.
Where do you get this?
Somebody will take this bullet out of my leg, I'll tell you.
So he speaks American.
And 10 other languages, my dear. But I don't tell anything I don't want to in any of them.
Anthony Quinn became a star in my eyes in that movie. The character that he was playing there was absolutely hypnotic, I'm telling you. It looked like something that I needed to identify with, and I did.
It was very fine shooting, my friend. You should try again with that one.
Nearly 10 years later, Anthony Quinn delivered an Oscar-winning performance as the brother of Mexican revolutionary Emiliano Zapata.
I'm a general. Look, here's my pay, a little dust. I can't even buy a bottle of tequila. We beat Diaz. He's living in a palace in Paris. We beat White. He's a rich man in the United States. I have to beg pennies in my own village when people never fired a gun.
To this day, I think Marlon Brando did a brilliant job of portraying a character that's hard to get a hold of because he was a myth. Still is, Emiliano Zapata.
Your relatives, with victory in their mouths, will never chew it. Now do you see why we have hard discipline? You told your wife where we would be and what? Shoot him.
It was a distortion that Zapata could not read, or that Pancho Villa could not read, or that Pancho Villa was a total illiterate.
Mariano.
Yes, you remember I once read to you about him in the newspaper?
You promised to teach me to read. I will.
Actually, these revolutionaries set up schools wherever they liberated areas. That's the first thing they did.
They plowed the land and they've got it half sowed. And they haven't got time.
Ilia Kazan put me in Viva Zapata with two of my idols. I mean, Marlon Brando and Anthony Quinn.
Phew. You ought to know the land can't wait. The furrows are open, the seeds not planted, and stomachs can't wait either.
High Noon introduced movie audiences to one of Mexico's top actresses, Katy Jurado.
I'm leaving town. I want to sell this store. You want to buy me out?
She had enormous dignity, great authority, and was a wonderful, is still a wonderful actress.
To be a Mexican woman in a town like this.
I hate this town. I always hated it. To be a Mexican woman in a town like this.
Yo creo que lo que más llamó la atención, que hasta ahora no se había pasado aquí en Estados Unidos, era que veía una mexicana, pero bien puesta y con mucha dignidad.
What Helen is a very independent and autonomous woman. She owns a saloon and she owns a store. And most significantly, she really is in control of her own sexuality.
Yes, but then again, she's a prostitute, fiery Latin prostitute. I mean, this was the only way that you saw, Latin women in movies.
It's very obvious that she's the madam, that she's an ex-lover of Gary Cooper, the sheriff. Yet, she felt to me like the core, the moral core of the movie.
I don't like anybody to put his hands on me unless I want him to. And I don't like you to anymore.
I remember being very proud to see her in that film and holding herself so regally. And playing such a central role in the movie. You know, you hold on to these things, and you're always looking for those people that you can identify with.
Get out, Harvey.
You don't mean that.
Try me.
And as I understand it, she left Hollywood because they had nothing for her here, and she wasn't about to do some of those Conchita Lolita roles that were usually in the offing for Hispanic women.
Hollywood resurrected the Latin lover image from its silent past in the romantic musicals of the era. Many featured Mexican-born leading man, Ricardo Montalban.
Well, fancy meeting you here.
Well, hey! Where did you come from?
South America.
And Nephew's daughter, we introduced a song called Baby, It's Cold Outside, which became a big hit in the country. And it won the Academy Award as the best song of the year.
Tomorrow. Think of my lifelong
At
sorrow.
At least there will be plenty implied.
If you got pneumonia and die,
I really can't
get
stay.
Over that old doubt.
Ah, but it's cold outside.
I was always complaining about always being the Latin lover, and I wanted to do films that had a little more content. And along comes Border Incident. And I played an agent from Mexico, and George Murphy played the counterpart, an American agent from the United States.
Pablo, here, sure, we're old friends. We worked on a case together in Brownsville, Texas, years ago.
In the 40s, the United States initiated the Bracero program, which brought thousands of Mexican farm workers across the border to free U.S. field workers for military duty.
Border Incident is a really interesting film because these are current events at the time, and it has to do with the Bracero program, and it has to do with abuses of the Bracero program and the way, you know, some of these Mexican laborers were just being exploited and abused.
That's where I'm going, where they pay what is right.
You can't, compadre, you can't. None of us can. We're here against the law, so the law can't help us.
Get in there. Stay there. What's going on in here? Get to bed, you monkeys. You got work to do in the morning.
It showed the American public an aspect of the honorable working man who is not somebody you sneeze at because he's a peon, you know, because he comes to work in the lettuce fields. Who's going to work in the lettuce fields?
Soon after Border Incident, Montalban went back to the roles audiences and the studios preferred.
See? Loops.
They were so politically correct that at times we become a bore, really a bore. We lost a little bit of the enchantment and the magic of make-believe and to have people smile and have a good time.
You feel this heart of mine with tropic heat. It has that chica boom boom, chica boom boom.
There was nothing detrimental about the Latin lover, you know, fortunately. Nothing that was hurtful or that the image suffered, no. He had elegance and it was beautifully photographed and very pretty, and the story was nonsensical but fun.
And that's how basically we represent it. With exceptions, every so often, maybe somebody will go see through the line and say, oh my God, Jose Ferrer did a wonderful job in Cyrano de Bergerac.
In 1951, Puerto Rican actor Jose Ferrer became the first Latino ever to win the Academy Award.
I clap my hands three times, thus. At the third, you will eclipse yourself. Ready?
I don't think Jose Ferrer was ever thought of as being, he was just a wonderful actor, you know, who happened to be from the island of Puerto Rico.
One.
How dare you?
I demand, I insist, I call upon all the nobles.
Two.
He is such a powerful presence and such a good actor that you better be acting or else he's going to blow you off the screen.
Three.
During the early 1950s, the anti-communist blacklist claimed the careers of many in the movie industry.
Are you a member of the Communist Party? Or have you ever been a member of the Communist Party?
It's unfortunate and tragic that I have to teach this committee the basic principles of Americanism.
That's not the question.
The blacklist forced some filmmakers to work outside the mainstream, but gave them the opportunity to make films that Hollywood would never make.
There was a picture that was produced called The Ring, an outstanding picture with respect to the reality that it captured, the East LA ambience. The actor, who was, I believe, cast right off the street, he looked real to me, he looked Chicano.
Lalo Rios played a young Chicano in Los Angeles with hopes that a boxing career would better his life. His girlfriend is played by then-newcomer, Puerto Rican actress Rita Moreno.
Fighter?
That's right. I had my first part tonight. This is nothing because I won, Lucy. I got paid $35 for just 15 minutes.
Fighting's dangerous. You can get hurt. Sometimes
they are two good people. They're everyone, all the family in it are good people. He's not a gangster. He's not a bad boy. She's anything but a bad girl. She's a good girl. She has very traditional Mexican values. She doesn't want him to box.
Where it absolutely failed is that the character failed. He didn't make it. He was a failure. And he had to learn to go back and live with his own people at his own level. That was the point of the movie. And even though it was put together, I think, by very liberal filmmakers who were weeded out, you know, with the communist witch hunts.
Salt of the Earth was made independently by blacklisted movie makers. They based their film on an actual miners' strike in New Mexico.
I told you it would happen. It's bound to happen when a man works alone.
Why did you give the man a warning signal?
Your foreman says that's a foreman's job.
You're a liar, Pancho. A no-good, dirty...
It critiques it also dealing with issues of race and class. Now, that's really revolutionary. Most importantly, the subjective voiceover of the film is the voice of a woman, the voice of a Chicana. Now, that is incredible.
The meeting was nearly over when we came in. Charlie Vidal was making a speech. He said there was only one issue in this strike, equality.
I count it as the beginning of Chicano cinema because the actual workers, Mexican-American workers, played themselves, many of them. They collaborated on the screenplay and they, you know, they forced the screenwriter to make some changes because they were not happy with it.
We women are not striking miners. We will take over your picket line.
Because of her work in this film, Mexican actress Rosara Revueltas was deported and her visa permanently revoked.
I have to work it out with myself.
You're in the wrong place, amigo. Come on, let's get out of here. Vamos, andale. Your money's no good here. Come on, let's go.
I'll never forget going to see Giant back in the 1950s. It's significant now, I think, because it really dealt with some of the social issues that relate to Latinos, Mexican Americans in particular, in Texas in this case, in a very dramatic and, I thought, ultimately enlightening way.
The white male protagonist is not a perfect hero.
We really stole Texas, didn't we, Mr. Benedict? I mean, away from Mexico.
You're catching me a bit early to start joking, Miss Leslie.
It becomes a movie about racism. And for those of us who saw it back in those days, it was just, you know, you didn't see movies explicitly addressing racism, specifically racism that I knew living in Texas.
But I'm not joking, Jordan. Why, it's all right there in the history books, isn't it? This mad Mr. Austin came down with about 300 families, it says, and the next thing you know, they're up and claiming it from Mexico.
It's 50 years ahead of its time. No movie recently has done that with as much sensitivity as that film did back then.
Cultures clash at the U.S.-Mexican border, resulting in a rarely seen dark view of Anglo justice.
Setting is a border town. There are all these kind of Mexican and Mexican-American hoodlums threatening Janet Leigh. On the other hand, you know, it's a critique of Anglo police force, Anglo justice.
No tienen ningún derecho de leer mis cartas. Tú eres policía mexicano y debes proteger a los
mexicanos. I don't speak Mexican.
I got no derechos aquí.
Eres cobarde. Y le tienes miedo a estos gringos.
Let's cheaper than English, Vargas.
And if you look at what's really going on, I mean, the Hank Quinlan character with Orson Welles is corrupt to the core.
Pedro Osara, telefono?
Being English, I don't like to repeat myself.
I merely asked him if I could
ask.
The telephone.
El teléfono está en la recámara.
It's a film that's really exposing what justice is like when you are at the margins.
The 60s gave rise to the new Western, with more bloodshed, and often an anti-hero replacing the traditional hero cowboy. But some things didn't change.
This is a time when Mexico as a market is not as important to Hollywood. And so then the final thing, you're coming out of the 50s, out of the tail end of the beginning of the civil rights movement, where it's a little more complicated to show disparaging images of blacks. And so in a sense, you know, Mexicans become kind of the easy stand-in for all of these things.
No! The days of good hunting are over. Now I must hunt with a price on my head. I'll be back.
Why do they go to Mexico? They go to Mexico or they go to Latin America either because they're on the run and they're criminals on the run and they're trying to escape the law, or they're looking for something that's against the law. They're looking for sex, they're looking for liquor, they're looking for gambling, they're looking for money, you know, they're looking for something illicit.
Senor, if you come with me, I'd show you where the gold is. But first, I sing for you. Or, do you think you can fool Lolita? It shows how little we've moved, and more important, how little understanding there is of the Latino population and sensibility in this country. They really don't know us.
The Wild Bunch is, you know, a pretty distressing look at Mexico. And, you know, it is vile and dark and disgusting. But that has to do partially with Sam Peckinpah's vision of the world, in which, you know, the world was a pretty vile place and there weren't very many heroes in the world that he creates.
I am to escort you to the general.
Any trouble? No guns for the general. Very smart. That's very smart for you, damn gringos.
My work as an actor in the Wild Bunch ended the first 4 weeks. But he kept me there for 14 weeks. Sam knew that I was a young director, on top of being an actor. And so he adopted me because he was teaching me. And he was one of my mentors, one of my tutors, and I owe him a lot in terms of what I know about filmmaking.
Some 20 years later, Alfonso Arau would direct the Academy Award-winning best foreign film, Like Water for Chocolate. A rare sympathetic view of Mexican women in Westerns of this era was presented by Marlon Brando in the only film he ever directed.
Decent woman I've ever met.
I'm sure you have met many nice women in your life before.
I met a few. Not many like you.
You also have a very wonderful bond between a mother and a daughter that is rarely seen for any race in Hollywood films.
Porque yo creí que me quería.
You didn't have to hear the words to understand what was going on. Marlon Brando was smart enough to let it play. Just, you know, we could watch their faces and understand everything.
Not until all the social change of the 60s occurred did ethnicity come in again, and it usually did not include Mexican Americans. What happened was Puerto Ricans were finally recognized in films like West Side Story.
West Side Story has my blood and guts in it. I really wanted to get that part very badly. I had to test a lot for it. They tested everybody with brown eyes and brown hair in the world for Anita. And there's so much of me in Anita.
You go get either, I will lock up.
But for the lead role, a major star was needed. And in 1961, there were no Latinas with that kind of star power.
You better be home in 15 minutes.
I kept wanting to understand why Natalie Wood was Maria.
Not to say that she didn't do a nice job of it, but it, you know, it just came clear to me that if you were the star, if you wanted to have the star roles, you were not going to be Latin.
Because Rita Moreno in West Side Story was such a vibrant, powerful, kick-ass performance that you got to remember, you got to be proud. And you go, wow, that's our people. And we can be funny, we can sing, we can dance, we have a lot of talent.
I know you don't smoke on your pipe and put Latin.
A small fee in America.
I really had no clue that she had won an Emmy, a Grammy, a Tony, and an Oscar. That's like, yes, magnificent. She's Puerto Rican. God bless her.
For her supporting role as Anita in West Side Story, Rita Moreno became the first Latina ever to receive an Academy Award.
I didn't do a film again after I won the Academy Award for 7 years. I was offered a few things, but they were more of the same gang movies. On a lesser scale, on a lower level.
And having won the Oscar, I said, that's it. I'm not going to do that anymore. And ha-ha, I showed them. I didn't do a film for 7 years.
For most Latino actors, starring roles were hard to come by in Hollywood. Henry Silva, who had supporting roles in The Manchurian Candidate and Ocean's 11, got a boost in his career by working in Europe.
I made 29 films in Europe where I played all different kinds of people. I didn't play anything that was offered to me that was one. I had choices. Anthony Quinn. Tony had to do the same thing. He became a major star in Europe by going over there. Over here, he was held back. And then by becoming important in Europe, he became important. I mean, Lawrence of Arabia and La Strada really made him.
After starring in La Strada, Mexican-born Anthony Quinn returned to Hollywood, won a second Academy Award, and was cast in major studio films.
The Arabs, the Hawitat, Ajili, Rala, Benisacher, these I know. I have even heard of the Harith.
Mon Rivera was no punk. Mon Rivera was almost the heavyweight champion of the world.
I never loved a man more than you.
A young Latina actress of Bolivian descent also gained international stardom in a popular British production.
1 Million Years B.C. was the breakthrough film for me, and that was the first time that somebody said to me, you have to dye your hair blonde. And I was, like, shocked.
Oodala.
I was like, what? What is this? I said, why do I have to be blonde? They said, because you're queen of the show, people. You're the good girl, you know. The bad girl has dark hair. So I went, ooh, that's not nice. But I did it.
The work of a filmmaker is very similar to the work of a magician, because really nothing is truth. Everything is make-believe.
By the late 60s, the unique talents of a number of Latino artists were sought after for some of the world's most cutting-edge, groundbreaking films. Argentinian-born composer Lalo Schifrin.
The music helps to hypnotize the audience. The music helps to create the mood, to make an ambiance for that make-believe.
Nobody can eat 50 eggs.
One of Lalo Schifrin's most well-known compositions is the Mission Impossible theme.
The music of Mission Impossible, it has a kind of strange Latin rhythm in 5-4, which 5-4 is an odd meter, but the rhythm is very, very Latin. Even in Bullet, one of my earliest movies, I come with a rhythm that I mix with the blues. The whole orchestra is doing a kind of guajira. I don't know.
Also working behind the scenes on Bullet was Cuban-American Pablo Ferro, graphic designer on numerous Academy Award-winning films.
I cut out a black and white photograph, and I cut out the word bullet in it. And I took the photo, and I took Steve outside, and I said, the background is in color, and I brought the card all the way up to his eyes. And as soon as he sees his eyes, he says, I love it. Let's do it. And that's what you saw in the movie, which black background in front, and then the lettering goes through, and inside is color. And it keeps moving and moving. The opening is very important to many films. Sometimes a film doesn't need it, sometimes a film needs it.
Ferro also designed the opening title sequence for another film classic.
Like Dr. Strangelove, let's say, after the film was finished, setting up the movie. You see a satire, what are you gonna see, comedy, a drama, whatever. The B-52 refueling helped the movie.
In the field of cinematography, Latinos introduced new styles and a fresh look. Recently, Mexican-born Emmanuel Lubezki received an Academy Award nomination for Best Cinematography on the visually complex film Sleepy Hollow. And a generation of cinematographers were inspired by the artistry of the great master, Gabriel Figueroa, whose work was celebrated in both Mexico and the U.S. Figueroa advanced the art of cinematography through the use of filters that made clouds stand out in the frame. This popular look became known as Figueroa skies.
Gabriel Figueroa, to me, is a master. You go to pictures that he has done, that he has photographed, they're just extraordinary.
One of the first great cinematographers, universally known, as a great artist.
In John Ford's The Fugitive, Gabriel Figueroa gave the film a distinctly Mexican look and feel through the bold use of light, shadows, and flickering candles. This major Hollywood production featured Mexican movie stars Pedro Armendáriz and Dolores del Río.
What are you doing here? Why did you leave your village?
My father made me leave. After you left.
Cuban-born Nestor Almendros was the first Latino to receive the Academy Award for Best Cinematography for his remarkable work in Days of Heaven.
His work, again, has a different touch to it. It's a different feel to it. And I don't know because he was from Cuba as opposed to Figueroa from Mexico, because I think that we're influenced by that. You know. Figueroa is, you know, Orozco and Tamayo and that influence, and Nestor, I think, more of the European artists that influenced him, you know. And they're both great men.
Okay, pal, let's have us a big smile.
I had shot a few pictures at Paramount, and Bob Evans felt that it sounds convoluted, but he called me and he said, I want you to meet Roman Polanski, I want you to shoot this movie because it's kind of about the Latin thing, you know. And I didn't really see that, but that's beside the point. I'm glad I got the job.
John Alonso received an Academy Award nomination for Best Cinematography on Chinatown. His distinctive talents have enhanced many major films, including Scarface.
Who put this thing together? Me! That's who! Who do I trust? Me!
It was sort of negative, but it was cool, too, at the same time. It was played by Al Pacino, who's a great actor. And I don't know, we've been shortchanged for the most part. You know, obviously, everybody knows that. We've always had to play, you know, always at the bottom, either drug dealers, killers, murderers, or we're maids and illegal aliens, and always at the bottom of the food chain.
Hollywood deals in stereotypes in every movie that it makes. It is not reality, folks. Okay, it is a concoction that's dramatized and fictionalized and has to take place within the space of a two-hour time frame.
A lot of stereotypes come about out of guilt, you know, in order to justify something that people down deep unconsciously know is unfair and not right, but they want to somehow compensate for it.
I remember when the talking pictures came, but they had more as a lazy Mexican with a hat over sitting there, you know, or bandidos. It didn't affect me. I didn't think. I thought it was funny. Now looking back, it wasn't that funny.
If you play, as an actor, you play a bandido, people think you are a bandido in real life. You know? On the other hand, you will never be a star if you play villains. So it's very, very complicated.
Because I'd rather have all the negative stereotypes in movies than not be present at all. Because at least you're represented somehow.
Tengo un mensaje para usted. No me entiendes.
Lady, he says you don't understand what he wants.
I understand very well what he wants.
Images that I saw on television, if you talk like this,
You were a moron, you know. You know, it really was. Your accent, but if I spoke with a French accent, I wasn't. I was sexy, you know.
Well, how do I get there?
Well, you go down this road until you come to a... No. You go down this road until you come to a tree, and then you turn to the... No. You go down this road until you come... Gee, I don't think you can get there from here.
There are good stereotypes, and there are bad stereotypes. And they divide, for the most part, according to color and size. Tall people are basically in, short people are out. Light people are basically in, dark people are out.
I don't think anybody goes out to make a totally insulting movie. They kind of think that what they're doing is pretty good. It's just based upon their intelligence and their art, where their intelligence meets their artistry. That's how they pull it off. Some do, some don't.
Hollywood is very influential in placing in the minds of people images of what we Latinos are. And unhappily, many of those images deal with gangs.
He said, my homeboy's vato. See, our homie here is all we have, man.
I love them. They love me back, man.
The urban gang film provided a training ground for a new generation of Latino actors, but many would consider it a mixed blessing.
I think of a self-perpetuating image, and Hollywood has had its hand on it from the very beginning. I'm thinking now of Blackboard Jungle and had Rafael Campos as a Puerto Rican punk.
I go down the stinking street with my stinking books, and then I meet the stink face who lives near me. And he says, you go to school, Pete?
You didn't see a lot of Chicano gangs in those days. And by the time we got to the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, the 90s, forget it, it's hardcore.
Gangster films are a staple of Hollywood, whether they're Chicano or Black or James Cagney being Public Enemy or Godfather, or, you know, some of the greatest films ever to exist, or about the gangs or gangster mentality. That's just part of who we are as Americans. We're a very violent society, and so we have this kind of attraction, repulsion with violence.
Many people regard gang films the way they regard gang members. They judge them, and they don't give them a chance. They don't look at the film as a film.
I wanted to be at your wedding and everything, man. I wanted to be there. But I just get real mad sometimes, and I don't know what to do.
The image of the gang, I think, has doubled back on itself and has created more gangs.
You want me to walk away from this, man?
What they're projecting is an identity.
No way.
A lot of the kids that are in California prisons got their first instruction off the big screen watching gangs.
Joining the Echo Park gang was all my idea. Our homegirls jumped us both in together. They kicked our asses for a whole minute, and we fought back to prove we were down.
A lot of the fault for that is directly attributable to this negative stereotype that continues to be perpetrated for the purpose of making money in the movies.
If you can go into the community and understand something about what's going on and the dynamics of the community, you have a much broader spectrum of characters and activities.
Edward James Olmos was the first Latino to direct a Hollywood feature film about gangs from the Latino perspective.
I remember when I was a little chavalito. I used to sit by the window, waiting for you to come home. I would get so anxious, I'd pinch myself in the hand until it would bleed.
I loved Eddie Olmos' American Me. I thought that was a beautiful, powerful attempt to capture that part of Latin life, you know? That exists.
It has helped multitudes of kids, black, white, brown, yellow, red, to have a chance to make a educated choice on the situations that they're dealing with.
Suddenly in the 1970s, you saw an explosion. Now, I think that it was due to some extent to the result of the civil rights movement finally coming to fruition. So you saw then people making a little more room. Not that Hollywood ever accommodates any minority group. They don't. If you're a minority group, you have to push. You have to fight to climb the mountain. You can't feel sorry for yourself in this business. You know, you have to be aggressive, you have to be positive, and you have to compete.
The first and probably major achievement of Latino filmmakers making feature films is that without almost any support from the industry, they have managed to make as many feature films about Latinos as the industry made in the previous 70 years.
It wasn't until the late 70s that Latino filmmakers began to make their own movies, telling stories in a voice that hadn't been heard before and presenting new images for the cinema. The telling of our stories through our own eyes created the bronze screen. Director Luis Valdez's first film was based on the true story of the Los Angeles Zoot Suit Riots.
The Zoot Suit Riots were a series of riots in the early 40s. What was going on is servicemen attacking Latinos, Mexican Americans, and beating them up and stripping them of the Zoot Suit.
Don't give me that bullshit. I got this filero from you.
Did I tell you to kill the vato? Control yourself, Hank. Don't hate your raza more than you love the gringo.
I played El Pachuco, which embodied a classic example of a subculture within the Mexican-American culture, Chicano culture.
It take more than the U.S. Navy to wipe me out, it's a...
But Zoot Suit was not box office. It was a critical success, but not a box office success.
What did become a box office success was a comedic caricature of the Latino lowrider and drug culture of the time.
Up in Smoke, I think, was the number six or five grossing movie of the year, in a big movie year. It was, eventually, I think it did like about 125 million worldwide back in 78, which there was no $100 million movies back then.
Hijo de la chinga!
Is that a joint, man?
Cheech and Chong was this huge money-making machine that was very much a part of the hit-making process of the industry. We made all studio films, and they grossed a lot of money, but we were never considered part of the industry at the same time. It's amazing. I was very comfortable with that.
Keep on knocking, but you can't come in.
Every time you see this, you multiply.
Cuban-American Ramon Menendez wrote and directed the true story of East Los Angeles high schoolers falsely accused of cheating. The film presented the image of Latino youth in a rare positive light.
Positive. Louder!
Olmos was nominated for an Academy Award for his portrayal of Bolivian math instructor Jaime Escalante.
Why?
The Academy Award nomination, which was a shock to us, because of the fact that it was such a modest, humble film.
Latino filmmakers shared with movie audiences an entirely new view of the immigrant experience.
What you have there in those films is it's countering kind of the popular news coverage of immigration. Our borders are being invaded, and it's almost like a horror film. You know, the monsters from outer space. You know, we're being invaded by aliens.
I set out to make El Norte in order to give a face and a heart to the shadows that pervaded Los Angeles.
Brother and sister, son de Guatemala.
Guatemala? Big deal. I get them from Guatemala, Salvador, Nicaragua. They're coming in from all South America, huh? Us Mexicans are beginning to be a regular minority around here.
I knew that there was a huge mixture of people, and at that time, a lot of them were refugees from wars in Central America. This tremendous drama happening, but to my friends who were not Latino, they saw none of it at all.
In El Norte, two Guatemalan immigrants endure hardships and heartache throughout their journey to their new lives in the U.S.
There is only one favorite film role that I have, and that is La Nacha, El Norte.
Ah, you want that I should show to her? Ah, yeah. Okay, sí.
Same age you.
Sí, don't worry about not seeing. Sí, sí, sí. Okay.
It was a composite that I created of all of those people that were a part of my life in my early years in El Paso, and all those women that came together in that one heart and soul and of that woman that was so dignified.
Written by Gregory Nava and Anna Thomas, El Norte received an Academy Award nomination for Best Screenplay.
Le Uchiha Telik Malri, Chinchubo, Kashta Kingwilo.
Nobody had any, thought that it was an Oscar contender. You know, you didn't think about an independent film in that way, and certainly not a film like El Norte.
Ay, mija. Si tú tratas de comprender a los gringos, te va a dar un dolorzazo de cabeza.
Alambrista, directed by Robert Young, brought to life the difficulties, frustrations, and overwhelming emotions experienced by many Mexican farm workers in the U.S.
Me quiero ir. Ahorita me quiero ir. Mañana,
mañana te vas.
Me quiero
ir
ahorita.
Come on. I was born in East LA.
Chicano comedian Cheech Marin gave the immigrant experience a comedic spin.
Good morning, LA.
And I was sitting in my kitchen one day and I was reading the newspaper, and there was a story about a kid that this happened to. He was 12 or 13, and he was deported, but he was a United States citizen. Born in the USA, was playing on the radio at the same time when I started singing Born in East LA, and it just cracked me up. It was a funny little title. And then I started writing this song, and it mostly as a parody at first, but then this other idea kept intruding itself, man, how to make kind of a social statement in a pop comic envelope, and the more I did it, like, oh, this is gonna be pretty cool.
And I won't lie to you, he's probably an illegal anyways, and so anyways, I go down to the factory to look for him, and he's not even there. And so when I'm walking around in the middle of the factory, and all of a sudden there's a goddamn immigration raid, and the doors fly open, and all these guys come busting in, and then they think that I'm an illegal, and they grab me and throw me in the bus.
The message was, it was a lot of things, you know, it was, here's the state of the art as far as the immigration question is concerned, in a funny way, but serious at the same time.
There's the first customer of the day. This is my pretty old buddy, doing candid camera.
It was the biggest film in New Zealand. It was the biggest film in the western part of the United States when it was released for four straight weeks, beating Lethal Weapon, all those kind of big studio action films.
Latino filmmakers told stories that focused on their own communities.
I wanted to tell a movie that was a very intimate story of family life. And I wanted to take the audience into a Chicano household in East LA. So I wanted actors that knew what that was like.
Listen, hermana, these are Jimmy's pants, see? And I want to make sure that they're properly ironed. And there's only one person in this whole goddamn world capable of doing that. That's me. Gracias. So, abórrate.
Abórrate.
It was a script that was very positive in terms of its approach and theme with regards to the Latino family in the United States and the multi-generational aspect of that.
And Jimmy here has a chance to play a stereotypical Latino, but with heart. You know, yes, we're playing bad guys, but we're playing good bad guys.
You have no right to hurt people this way.
I got the right. I don't want to see nobody. I don't want to hear from nobody. ¿Entiendes?
You know what this is gonna do to our jefita and our jefito? No estás pensando, tú. Look at you, got a son.
I got nothing, carnal.
I remember looking around me at the audience to see how they were reacting, and they laughed a lot. These were non-Hispanic people. They cried. They were brushing away the tears at the end of the movie. And I thought, you think that's something? If we only had more of a chance to show you more of ourselves, you would come to love us. You would come to ask for more of us.
The human experience is the human experience, no matter what color, race, religion, whatever you are. It's the same damn thing with the different packaging.
Producer Moctezuma Esparza told the magical story of one man's battle to save his bean field.
I have so many people that tell me that Milagro is one of their favorite movies.
What's the matter, Bernie? You afraid this thing will keep you from getting reelected?
Nah. Got a heavy majority in this town.
Come on, you beat Luis Armijo by 2 votes.
That's because Domingo and Guzdor were out of town.
So you would have won by 4?
Hell no, man. Those guys vote 6-7 times apiece. And I love Bernaya Montoya because Bernaya Montoya is a character who's in the middle. So they're trying to make both sides understand each other, which is pretty much the way I felt many times in my life.
Listen, around here, you and me, we gotta stick together, man.
Yep. What are you talking about?
I'm talking about not letting these niggers and spicks take over this realm, man.
My last name is Garcia, boss. Joel Garcia.
Writer-director Neil Jimenez told a dramatic yet humorous story based on his own experience in a West Coast rehabilitation center.
Ooh, Garcia! Garcia! Oh, boy, that's deep. That is deep.
The talents of real-life Latino musicians were moved into the cinematic spotlight by Latino writers and directors.
I like stories of people that are never heard. I did Crossover Dreams, which was a composite of the New Yorican musicians. And they play in what they call this Cuchifrito circuit around New York City. It was financed by friends, by us, by money, from whatever it came from. We never asked questions. El aire que trae en sus manos, la flor del pasado, su aroma de ayer. Nos dice muy quedo al oído, su canto aprendido del atardecer. I think that in the late 80s, in 87, when La Bamba came out, they found out, a lot of people found out that there's a great Latino audience willing to go to the movies and have a good time and see films.
La Bamba was a box office success because that was my intention. I set out to prove that yes, you can make a commercially successful Latino-themed film.
When I read that story, I knew that this was going to be a great film, and I knew that I had to play the brother Bob. Yeah.
We did La Bamba with a complete cast of unknowns.
Rosie, this is my brother Bob.
I'm very proud of that movie. I'm very proud that it showed the fact that people want to see, they want to see the legit thing.
The life of the late Tejano singing sensation Selena Quintanilla was celebrated by writer-director Gregory Nava and producer Moctezuma Esparza. Born and raised in the Bronx, Jennifer Lopez starred in Selena, which became her breakthrough role, catapulting Lopez into international stardom.
All the roles are opening up, lead roles. You don't have to be a drug dealer all the time now and a gang member or the villain of a movie or die in the first 30 seconds. You can last through the whole picture.
The first film I ever did was called So Young, So Bad.
My first job was as an extra. And I was playing an Indian with no dialogue.
I screen tested and got the part of the little Spanish girl who runs away from home, was very neurotic, and ends up hanging herself because they cut her hair.
My first job, well, funny to say, it was a prostitute.
It was first grade. I played a Mexican jumping bean. Little did I know I would be playing Mexicans for the rest of my life, ironically enough. Typecasting even at six.
My first job in film was doing cigarette commercials in Puerto Rico, and my job was to light the cigarettes.
My very first speaking role was opening the door in the film called Lifeguard. And I was the housekeeper, and I said, come in.
My first job in show business was sweeping floors at WFAA TV in Dallas. That's show business.
This decade promises to have a breakthrough in stars. We've got Jennifer Lopez, we have Selma Hayek, and Jimmy Smits and John Seda, Edward James Olmos. And there's a whole new group of young stars that are just waiting to break through.
What's that you say?
I said that you're a lying member of a no good race.
It's much better than you, you stinking Irish pig.
Oh, I like him.
Cuban-born actor Andy Garcia's work in over 20 films established him as an international star. He was nominated for an Academy Award as Best Supporting Actor for his role in The Godfather, Part 3.
Don Vincenzo Corleone.
Peter the Great? Who is the Emperor Constantine? Who is King John?
He's in his own, man.
Who is Victoriano Huerta?
You are right.
Puerto Rican actress Rosie Perez has proven her talent in both dramatic and comedic roles.
You know what time it is?
Miss Perez was nominated for an Academy Award for her remarkable performance as a grieving mother in Fearless, which also featured then-newcomer Benicio del Toro.
Get up. Get up, Colin. Colin. Get up. If doctors brought someone to Good Samaritan. Come on, you read about him in the paper.
Oh, Manny. Please, just let me die. Please.
8 years later, Del Toro's work in the film Traffic would garner him an Academy Award for Best Supporting Actor.
Good morning, senor.
Good morning, senorita.
Spanish leading man Antonio Banderas became the Latin lover of the 90s in a series of big-budget productions. And Raul Julia brought a certain magic to the art of acting.
Some called him inhumanly evil.
No!
Only our parents. I called him brother.
For me, the mark of a real artist is to be able to, in your lifetime, show a type of versatility with regards to the work that you do.
Even when he plays stereotypes, he gave it a flavor.
Indeed! For Festa!
For Festa, a brother!
My brother!
One of a kind!
The doctor's all sent!
Kind to animals, so good with children.
They never proved anything.
$1 million is the perfect amount.
It's brilliant.
Somebody who really kind of immerses into a role and becomes somebody else. Those are the actors that I really kind of like, I'm drawn to. And certainly Raul was like that.
Tell me what his son looks like.
Colombian-born John Leguizamo continues in the tradition of Raul Julia, exhibiting the exceptional talent to interpret a wide range of roles on the bronze screen.
I think God's telling me that I'm going to burn in hell if I don't stop cheating.
I am a Latin actor, and that will always influence me, and I don't see why I have to not be that. I mean, that's part of me, and because I write and I like to write Latin stories, yeah, I'm a damn Latin actor.
By the 90s, a number of Latin directors had made their mark in mainstream Hollywood cinema in a range of styles, themes, and genres. Director Robert Rodriguez brought a daring twist to the action-adventure genre with his directorial debut, El Mariachi. His unique talent was recognized by a major studio which remade the super low-budget film as Desperado. It featured Antonio Banderas and Mexican-born Selma Hayek, who also starred in his popular cult feature, From Dusk Till Dawn.
Robert Rodriguez grew up with a little video camera in his hand, watching TV and watching movies and learning how to make movies as a kid, just like Spielberg did.
People ask me whether I see future for Latin actors and actresses in the United States. That will depend on the support our community provides to the idea that we are tired of being portrayed as losers, as hoodlums, as people who are not contributing positively to this country.
We have the talent, we have the beauty, but those of us that have pioneered the way, you might say, have had to struggle a great deal, and we continue to struggle.
It's never our time unless we set the watch and say, now. That's our time, and that's it.
It will change because the people from our community will take it upon themselves to write the films and direct the films and produce the films and tell their own truth instead of watching somebody else do it for them.
It'll change in the way that Hollywood has always changed, through competition, through achievement, through artistry, through doggedness, through an unwillingness to give up.
Hey, we're gonna throw tax in your road, and we're gonna throw, every once in a while, we're gonna throw like you know, bears and boulders, and you're, because you are Speedy Gonzalez, you're gonna get around them or die. Okay.
Okay.
So that's my contribution to 100 years of filmmaking. I wanna make another movie.
Hollywood is a communicator of the American dream to the world. And the world
is all hungry for this American dream. And as Hollywood communicates that that dream belongs to all of us, that we all participate equally in it, then the world is going to be impacted by that as well. And we're all going to benefit from it.
Latinos have been making movie history since the first camera rolled. By sheer force of their talent, persistence, and artistry, they helped shape the 20th century's greatest art form. This legacy now continues into a new century, lighting up the silver screen in shades of glorious bronze.
In the golden age of cinema, Rita Hayworth epitomized Hollywood glamour like no other. She was the legend known as the Love Goddess. But her rise to stardom was a long journey. She began her Hollywood career as Margarita Concino, her real name, appearing in 10 small films before changing her name to Rita Hayworth.
People used to say, "Oh, you know, Rita wasn't that good looking until they changed her hair." And then I went into the books and I would look and see Rita when she was really super young, just a teenager with a dark, dark hair. And she was gorgeous. I mean, she was every bit as gorgeous. She was just different. She looked more ethnic.
After appearing in some 31 feature films, Rita Hayworth finally got her break into international stardom with a standout performance in the star-studded film Blood and Sand.
Rita Hayworth as Doña Sol, alluring adventuress, woman of the world with an irresistible fascination.
If this is death in the afternoon, she is death in the evening.
But Rita's most memorable role by far is that of screen siren Gilda.
What did you say to him?
I just told him if a man answers, hang up. About me, Gabe. If I'd been a ranch, they would have named me the Bar Nothing.
There never was a woman like Gilda, or a picture like Gilda. Columbia's outstanding screen triumph, starring Rita Hayworth with Glenn Ford.
That's what I told Bella, and that's what you're going to tell me.
Making me deceive my husband.
I got some news for you, Gilda. He didn't just buy something. He's in love with you.
One man bought Gilda, another hated her and hungered for her.
hate you so much that I think I'm going to die from it. Darling.
Gilda, inflaming men's hearts with a kiss or a song.
Amor mio, love me forever, and let forever begin tonight. Put the blame on men, boy. Put the blame on men. One night she started to shim and shake. That brought on the Frisco quake.
Make her stop. What do you mean by it?
Now they all know what I am. And that should make you happy, Johnny. It's no use just you knowing it, Johnny. Now they all know that the mighty Johnny Farrow got taken. And that he married a...
Off screen, Ms. Hayworth's personal life often made headline news. Her courtship and marriage to Prince Ali Khan made her the most publicized woman in America. In 1949, the world watched newsreels of the royal wedding, her third marriage, and her daughter Yasmin was born soon thereafter. Sadly, the marriage ended after a bitter court battle, after only 2 years. But by 1953, Rita returned to the screen to deliver what many critics said was her best singing, dancing, and acting performance to date, as the provocative and sultry Miss Sadie Thompson.
All the votes that haven't been sown, they might start a chain reaction, and I might explode. The heat is on, the heat is on. You're gonna hear the sirens howl tonight. You're gonna see the building bounce. Because the lady's on the prowl tonight, and it behooves me to announce the heat is on.
Miss Thompson,
may I ask where you're going?
Oh, the boys are throwing a brawl at the Chinaman.
You'll be the only white woman there.
You're going to New Caledonia to carry on your trade.
What?
How could I marry you when I think of all the guys who had their hands
on you? Get out of here! Out of here! Get out!
Regardless of all the rain and mud, the feel of the place gets in your blood. But deep in the night there comes unawares the terrible thought that nobody cares. You're back with the blues again. To be even more specific, you've got what they call the blue Pacific blues.
Don't come near me.
No, be
no,
careful.
No, no, no.
Co-star and Academy Award winner Jose Ferrer said, when Rita is called before the camera, she illuminates the whole scene. She carries the picture. Though critically acclaimed and a source of professional pride for Mrs. Hayworth, Miss Sadie Thompson was not a huge box office success.
See, I did the picture with her, but I didn't do a, I didn't have a scene with her, you know. It's called The Money Trap with Glenn Ford. But I got to know her on the set. And she made a beeline for me, and she held my hand, Ricardo. And she almost made my hand bleed. She was so scared. She said, Ricardo, what do I do? What do I? I said, oh, you don't have to do anything. Just look pretty there, Rita. Just relax. And she was shaking. People thought that she was drunk when she was suffering from Alzheimer's. She was a very, very sweet person. I felt very sorry for her. Rita, yes, she was a tragic girl, and so attractive. I had such a wonderful career, you know. She was a big, big star.
Rita Hayworth became the object of unkind gossip and bad press when her behavior became somewhat erratic and her memory began to falter. After 5 marriages, a movie career spanning some 37 years, and a long battle with what we now know as Alzheimer's disease, Rita Hayworth died in her daughter Yasmin's New York apartment in 1987 at the age of 68. The New York Times obituary aptly read, "She was the epitome of Hollywood glamour and allure, a stunningly beautiful actress and dancer." Every character he has ever played, Anthony Quinn brought an intensity and magic that was larger than life. Throughout his movie career, Quinn convincingly portrayed a wide range of nationalities. Resisting categorization, he once told an interviewer, "Acting is my nationality." The Mexican-Irish actor was born Anthony Rudolph Oaxaca Quinn in Chihuahua, Mexico in 1915. Multi-talented from the start, Quinn dabbled in music as a young man living in Los Angeles. Later in life, he became an accomplished visual artist. Well known for his colorful and eclectic personality, few know that the actor was at one time a professional boxer with 16 consecutive victories under his belt. Quinn's movie career began in 1936, but it wasn't until the early 50s that he got his breakthrough role to stardom in Viva Zapata and an Oscar for Best Supporting Actor.
Did you take the land away from these people?
I took what I wanted.
Juanita?
I took their wives, too.
What kind of an animal are you?
Huerta's forces are coming through the pass, Emiliano.
Emiliano, I give you my word. I will stop the troops.
I hope so, but if you can't, I will.
And just 4 years later, Quinn would take home a second Oscar as Best Supporting Actor for his role as the painter Gauguin in Lust for Life.
Why don't you shut up? If you have to slobber, don't do it over me. When have you done a stroke of manual labor in your life? Well, I have. I've dug ditches in the stinking heat of the tropics. I worked in the docks and weather-soaked coal. My hands froze to the ropes. And I can tell you there's nothing noble or beautiful about it. I did it so I could go on painting. I didn't have a brother to support me.
By the early 60s, he had achieved international stardom.
Anthony Quinn as Auda Abu Taiki.
I carry 23 great wounds, all got in battle. 75 men have I killed with my own hands in battle. I scatter, I burn my enemies' tents. I take away their flocks and herds. The Turks pay me a golden treasure, yet I am poor. Because I am a river to my people.
But Quinn's immortal character portrayal was that of the exuberant and lusty Greek peasant Zorba.
Zorba,
you are in paradise.
Yet there is no better word for Anthony Quinn, voted Best Actor of the Year by the National Board of Review, for the role he was born to play, Zorba the Greek.
Remember this. If a woman sleeps alone, it puts a shame on all men. God has a very big heart, but there is one sin he will not forgive. If a woman calls a man to her bed, and he will not go.
Everything about the film and the man is different. When Zorba talks, you listen.
I have done things for my country that would make your hair stand. I have killed, burned villages, raped women.
When Zorba drinks, you taste it. When Zorba loves, you feel it. Because this is a man who devours life as if it were a feast, A man who never puts off till tomorrow what he can enjoy today. Here is his world. Sea-bathed, sun-washed Greece. Its sights, its sounds, its music, its dancing. Above all, here are its people. As proud as the silent village beauty whose desires only Zorba understood.
And they hate her because they cannot have her. Only one man here can. You.
The vulnerable English youth whom Zorba sent stumbling into love. The Rabelaisian French Madame, who was loved by no less than four admirals. People as proud, as cruel, as revengeful, as murderous, as their barren, mountainous homeland.
You bastard mountain! I'll eat your guts!
And overshadowing them all, Zorba fighting for life, laughing at death, attaining his place among the immortal characters of our time.
This time, his unforgettable role as Zorba won him an Academy Award nomination as Best Actor. Anthony Quinn's impressive career spanned over 60 years, garnered him two Academy Awards, and created a screen legacy that lives on in the hearts and minds of millions of movie fans throughout the world. Fabulous Rita Moreno has won the most prestigious awards an actress, dancer, singer, and comedian can receive. And with a movie career spanning over 50 years, she continues to delight stage and screen audiences to the present day. Rita Moreno was born Rosa Dolores Alverio in Humacao, Puerto Rico. With a natural talent apparent even as a young child, she began performing professionally at the age of 7 in local New York clubs.
My first job in show business was dancing with my dance teacher, Paco Cancino, who had great fame then for being Rita Hayworth's uncle, because she was Margarita Cancino.
Ms. Moreno's screen debut began in the early 50s, appearing in a handful of smaller films such as The Ring.
I wanted more than anything else in the world to be a singer and dancer for MGM Studios. That was the studio of any young person's dreams who was a musical person.
Rita's first big break came in 1956, when she was cast in the widescreen spectacular, The King and I.
The King and I was under contract to Fox at the time, 20th Century Fox. And I was obviously the most likely contender to play the role of Tupton because there was nobody else around, they felt, who could play that. They might have tried finding an Asian girl, but I don't think it occurred to them. I'm sure there are plenty of Asian girls nowadays who look at that film and say, ugh, Puerto Ricans playing a Thai. It's a great experience, and it is where I met Jerome Robbins, for which I shall ever be grateful.
Just 4 years after The King and I, Jerome Robbins cast Rita in her most unforgettable role in the all-time classic movie, West Side Story.
Ever going to be another film like that.
It gave me a world fame I would not have had otherwise. It gained me an Academy Award, which is pretty spectacular. Not too many people can say that. It afforded me the opportunity to work with a genius, Jerome Robbins, and of course, my wonderful Robert Wise, the director. And I got to dance.
I like to be in America. Okay, by me in America. Everything free in America.
For a small fee in America.
Well, I thought Rita was fantastic. I thought she was just brilliant, and you know, she just lit up the screen. And obviously she was nominated for an Academy Award. West Side Story has my blood and guts in it. There's so much of me in Anita. Not because I went with a gang guy, I never did, I wasn't that kind of person, but that same vivacity, that same aliveness, that same spirit to prevail no matter what happened.
Smoke on your pipe and put let it.
We are a very juicy people in emotional terms, which is terrific. I noticed that Anglo people are always kind of titillated by our energy. It's a wonderful plus that we have. It scares them too, but that's only because they don't know us.
I heard on the grapevine there's going to be a big producer out in the front watching your show tonight, unquote. Someday, you're going to see the name of Googie Gomez in lights, and you're going to say to yourself, was that her? And then you're going to answer to yourself, that was her. But you know something, mister? I was always her, just nobody knows it.
Who the hell was that?
Crazy Rita.
Did he really say that?
I want to play the South American girls from the movies, you know. I could be another Lana Turner, or I could be Barbara Streisand, Betty Midler.
Fabulous actress. She's such a good performer.
Rita Moreno is a goddess who should be framed. I want her forever. Rita is an amazing actress, a very versatile actress. I mean, she can act, she can sing, she can dance. She always took pride and embraced all that she was, you know, and because of her, a lot of us are working. I mean, it's like such, you know, I didn't realize it until we went to that tribute for her. I really had no clue that she had won an Emmy, a Grammy, a Tony, and an Oscar.
In long overdue recognition for her remarkable stage, screen, and musical career, Rita Moreno was recently honored with an Everlasting Star on Hollywood's Walk of Fame.